I have learned that God will not surrender His will for my life, nor will He surrender His will for your life. He will, He is determined, and He will persist. We are so delighted that you stopped in today. Our desire is to provide you with scriptural teaching to bolster your personal walk with God. Trust you'll enjoy the selection. May you receive it with an open heart and a spirit of prayer.
God bless you all.
Praise the Lord, everyone, and welcome to another Bible study here at the Smith Residence. We're so delighted that you've come to be with us today and to share with us a moment as we discuss a theme out of the Word of God. I trust that you are doing well, you and yours in your home, and that you are enjoying the blessings of the Lord. I want to share another thought today on the theme of things that I have learned, and direct your attention to the book of Acts chapter 26, and I'll read there between verses 9 through 15. The Bible says this: I verily thought with myself that I ought to do many things contrary to the name of Jesus of Nazareth, which thing I also did in Jerusalem. And many of the saints did I shut up in prison, having received authority from the chief priest. And when they were put to death, I gave my voice against them. And I punished them oft in every synagogue, and compelled them to blaspheme. And being exceedingly mad against them, I persecuted them even into strange cities. Whereupon, as I went to Damascus with authority and commission from the chief priest, at midday, O king, I saw in the way a light from heaven, above the brightness of the sun, shining round about me and them which journeyed with me. And when we were all fallen to the earth, I heard a voice speaking unto me and say in the Hebrew tongue, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks. And I said, Who art thou, Lord? And he said, I am Jesus, whom thou persecutest. This text, of course, comes from the testimony of Paul before King Agrippa. And he is talking about his Damascus Road experience. He was on a mission to destroy. He despised everything that pertained to the way, or as they called the church at that time, the people of the way. He wanted to crush the newborn persuasion that had blossomed about and over Christ Jesus. They were an offense to him, to Saul of Tarsus. They bothered him to no end. You must remember that Saul was a nationalist. Anything that opposed the nation of Israel was to be crushed, eliminated. Judaism was at the very core of the nation of Israel and paramount to its identity. Therefore, if it wasn't aligned with the Shema, it was heresy in his understanding and mind, and it required to be stamped out. Saul of Tarsus was a politician, schooled under the tutelage of Gamaliel, and a Pharisee by persuasion, and he had a plan. But I have an additional theory about this event that I read about here in the book of Acts. I believe that even before the Damascus encounter, God had already begun to work in the heart of Saul of Tarsus. He had seen Stephen martyred and seen the glory of the Lord and his countenance that he showed true godliness in that time. Hearing the words that Jesus spoke to him on that faithful day kind of lend itself to that persuasion as well. For Jesus said, "It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks." Let me put it in easier terms for you to understand. God told Saul, "Stop doing yourself harm." Everyone knows that the ox goad, which the Lord was using as in his example, if you kick it, it is sharp. It is and can be painful. Why are you willingly fighting against that which you know, Saul, will hurt you? Why are you willingly subjecting yourself to misery and pain? Why do you insist on rebelling against God? As I said, I'm persuaded that God had already begun his call on the heart of Saul of Tarsus. But Saul wanted no part of it. He had a plan. His life was already charted out. Politics and a place perhaps in the Sanhedrin was his ambition. But God's persistence stood in the way of what he wanted. And Saul, why are you fighting against the inevitable? In December of 1960, a boy was born into a Memphis home. It was a family of six already, and he was to be the seventh and the only son of these parents. His parents and older sisters were delighted that they were going to have a baby brother, because with a baby brother they could play house, and it's always more fun to play house with a real baby than with baby dolls. They thought in their heart, and whether they did or not, I'll never confess, dressed him in doll's clothes and had all types of fun in his infancy. But this wasn't the only peculiarity about this family, for the father was a full-time minister and a pastor, a church planter. So church and ministry was at the center of this family's world in every degree. The girls of the family sang and played instruments. The mother was a renowned children's speaker, and you perhaps could call her a camp meeting speaker at children's camps. Everything about them evolved around ministry in one facet or another. So when the boy began to grow up, it was an accepted fact that he too would become an intricate part of that family ministry team. But he didn't think the same. He didn't have the same thoughts. After all, his dad never had fun like the other dads of his friends, as he saw. His dad never went fishing except if it were for the purpose of ministry, and he was trying to reach somebody with the gospel who was an avid fisherman. His dad never played sports except if it were to enable him to build bridges to someone and thereby lead them into a relationship with God. His father was consumed with ministry 24/7, and recreation was not in his vocabulary in any way, shape, or form. And so from the boy's perspective, his dad was simply not cool. To make matters worse, his sisters, who of course were all older than him, began to get married when they turned of age. His oldest sister was the first to marry, and she married an evangelist, a minister of all things. His second sister married a young man who was a seminary student with ambitions to become involved in pastoral work as well. And then his third sister, to his chagrin, got engaged and married a young minister, also an evangelist. Things were, by this young boy's assessment, getting way out of hand. And then well-meaning people would come up to him and pat him on the back and mess up his hair and say, ah, you're going to be a preacher just like your dad someday, aren't you? I know you're going to be just like your father. You're going to grow up and be just like him. But nothing was further from the truth in that boy's ambition and heart. He wanted nothing to do with the family business. My observations were this: ministry was not for me. Because all the preachers that I had ever known were poor, financially strapped, and I didn't want to be financially strapped and poor. I wanted candy when I wanted candy. And all the preachers that I knew were constantly on the go helping others. And I was a little more narcissistic, and I wanted to do things that I wanted to do and not be on the go aiding others. And all the preachers that I had known had church problems to deal with, and cantankerous saints, God forbid. And nope, that wasn't my forte. I wasn't going to take that road. Suffice it to say, I did not want anything to do with ministry. And specifically, I did not want to be a preacher. But something had begun to stir in my heart at a very young age, perhaps as was in Saul's heart. Others saw it, while I, on the other hand, refused to acknowledge it. In 1978, I visited a church in West Memphis and had a fresh encounter with God. During that encounter, God asked me, what an audible voice, but it was clear nevertheless, and I knew it was the Lord speaking to me. And he asked this: will you preach for me? I did everything within my power while tears were running down my cheeks, and I was seeking to liberate myself from the guilt of sin that I had been involved in, for the preacher had preached a mighty message that night. And finally, as a last resort, I finally acquiesced and have said, okay, Lord, if you want me to preach, that's what I'll do. I had a breakthrough that night, but it wasn't long after that, days, weeks, perhaps a month after, that I crawfished and refused and backed up on my agreement and went back to a lifestyle of rebellion. It had been a continued practice and a philosophy of mine that if I was to be bad enough, God would change his mind. So I lived purposefully a rebellious and sinful life, thinking that God would see me as damaged goods and would release me from this calling that he had upon my life to the ministry. I hope God would see that I was a bad fit for his purpose as a preacher. Multiple times during this season, God had spared my life from peril that I had placed myself in through my rebellion, and steered me away from harm and from legal damage and scourge to my name. And though I persisted in sin and continued in gross sin, God never changed his mind. Maybe I'm wrong, but I'm kind of the opinion that Saul had a like philosophy. He didn't want anything to do with that Jesus or follow after that teaching of those of the way. He had political plans. He didn't want to change his plans and surrender to what was stirring in his heart of God. Saul did things that were obviously evil. He arrested Christians, falsely accusing them, those followers of Christ. He was involved in the unjust persecution of Christians, saints of that day. He facilitated in at least one slaying, and that being of Stephen. He was an evil man by any man's or anyone's estimation, but God would not and refused to change his mind for the plan that he had for Saul of Tarsus' life. Allow me to share something I came across this week, and I think you'll enjoy it. You may have heard it yourself. And that is, note these followers or these folk that were chosen of God in the scripture. Abraham was chosen, but he was an old man when he got chosen. Elijah was chosen, but if you look at Elijah, he was just a little bit fragile, and some may even suggest that he was suicidal, trying to run from Jezebel. Joseph was damaged goods. Everyone knows that he was damaged goods, for he was abused. He was the black sheep of the family, and his brothers hated him. Job, well, he had financial problems. He went bankrupt. How could God use such as that? Moses had a speech impediment. How could he be a pulpiteer, a minister, a preacher? Gideon was a fearful man. Some might even say that he was a coward. Samson, he was an atrocious individual. He was a womanizer. Rahab was a prostitute. And Noah, he was a drunk. Jeremiah was too young. He began his ministry, as some may estimate, in his early 20s. And Jacob was a cheater. David was a murderer. Peter denied the Lord 3 times. Zacchaeus was too short of stature to stand before men and proclaim the word of God. And to boot, he was an embezzler in his business dealings. And there were, of course, the disciples that were there in the garden with the Lord during his passion, who suffered from laziness and perhaps narcolepsy. And the list could go on and on. God has always chosen the undesirable, the imperfect, the flawed, the broken, and the weak. The Bible says it like this in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 27 through 31. But God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise, and God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. The base things of the world and the things that are despised hath God chosen, yea, and the things which are not, to bring to naught things that are, that no flesh should glory in his presence. But of him are ye in Christ Jesus, whom of God is made unto us wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption, that according as it is written, he that glorieth, let him glory in the Lord. God chose the foolish. He chose the weak. He chose the base things and persons to do his bidding. He wanted to be the wisdom. He wanted to be the righteousness. He wanted to be the one working through vessels to bring sanctification and redemption to the masses. That's why he chose the likes of me. And again, God told Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse number 9, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. So I repeat, God cannot be dissuaded by your being bad or faulty or damaged goods. God will and cannot have his will changed once he has appointed to you a purpose and a plan. Yes, God takes your will and subjects it to his will. God will accomplish his purpose in you, or you will die as he wrestles with you to bring about his purpose. One final thought. I could never have imagined how wonderful life in Christ would have ever been. Have you ever had saints to rise up against you, Marcus, as a pastor? Absolutely. I've had them where they wanted to crucify me with or without a cross. Have you ever been in financial straits and crises in ministry? More times than I would ever care to recall. There have been some rough times. Have you ever been at others' disposal and beckoning call when you would rather been out fishing or hunting or playing? Yes, for years on end. Was it enjoyable all the time? No, it was not. But being in God's will was always enjoyable and pleasurable and fulfilling. The life that God has given me has far exceeded my far-reaching hopes and aspirations. I am wealthier today than I deserve to be, and I'm not wealthy, but I am. God has made me comfortable. My health is better than I have a right to enjoy after the years of punishing my body and sin. I have more peace and joy in my life than what other paths or any other path could have provided for me. There are individuals across the globe who are genuine friends that I could call out to and find assistance that this life as a minister has provided me. I am mightily blessed of the Lord. I only wish that I had surrendered sooner. So if you're struggling with God's plan for your life, maybe to your chagrin, He wants you to do something like be a preacher, a pastor, or something deplorable like that in your mind, I would encourage you, don't resist. If you will surrender, you will find peace in trouble. If you will surrender, you will find companionship in the struggle. You won't have to bear the load alone. And my friend, you will find a friend that sticks closer than a brother, as stated in Proverbs 18:24. So what are you waiting for? Give up the fight. Don't kick against the pricks. Let the Lord take over. So in closing, what have I learned? I have learned that God will not surrender His will for my life, nor will He surrender His will for your life. He is determined, and He will persist. Jeremiah 29 and 11 says this, and I read from the King James, I read from the New International Version. For I know the plan I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. I am a testimony of that truth. If He wants you to be a preacher, you'll only find joy and peace in life in obeying His call. If He's wanting you to do some other sort of ministry, in this nation or abroad, the truth yet still stays the same. There was a song that we used to sing years ago. It says something like this: give up and let Jesus take over. Give up. And I don't really remember the rest of the words, but that's what we need to do. Give up and let Jesus take over. And when you do, Jesus said in John chapter 10 and 10, I am come that ye might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. I pray today that you've been blessed by this little thought of mine and this lesson that I've learned in life. It's been a delight sharing with you the Word of God. I trust you found it to be inspirational and informational. and that you will pursue your walk with God with a renewed vigor and determination and surrenderance. Please also check out our other postings. We have our webpage, theopendoorministry.org, Facebook page, entitled by the same name, YouTube, where this video will be posted. My wife has blogs that she posts on our website that she also reads and shares them in a podcast called Breadcrumbs Podcast. I think you'll enjoy them. Remember, click the subscribe button, the notification bell, the like button. Share us with a friend. If you would like, email us at RevMDSmith@theopendoorministry.org. We'd love to hear from you, share your thoughts, your testimony, or something that you would like or feel led of the Lord to do. Look forward to being with you again next week with another Bible study or thought pertaining to the Word of God. But until next time, I trust that you will be well, that you will be blessed. Have a wonderful week. God bless. Bye-bye.